I have had what you'd call a sighting, not encounter. I drive a bread delivery truck. I deliver to some larger grocery stores, but I have a lot of smaller accounts in the out-of-way rural areas, too. It was about 8:30 a.m., May 2011. It was past sunrise, but it was drizzling rain and gray out. I was heading to Duncan Falls for a delivery. I was driving along the river. There are stretches that you can see the river through the trees and other places that you can't. I was coming into one of the places where you can't. That's when I saw a Bigfoot walk right across the road, 200 feet in front of me or so. It came from my left side, walked across the road, which has four lanes, two going each way, and then it stepped over the guardrail and went down, I guess, into the river, because it dropped down from my view and I couldn't see it anymore. I looked as I passed that spot, but there was no sign of it. I don't know where it went. When I saw it, I started to brake the truck, but I really didn't have to. It had already crossed the road and gone down before I would have ever hit it. I can't tell you much about it except it was tall and it was covered in brown fur. It never looked at me. It wasn't running, but it crossed over in front of me very fast. It was upright, walking, too thick front to back, and with that and the fur, I know it was a Bigfoot. There isn't anything else walking on two legs with all of that. So that's it. I can't tell you any why fors or what fors, just that it did what it did. I've driven that way hundreds of times for deliveries and never saw anything before or since. Thanks, the bread guy. Hi, Nance. I love listening to the experiences and the stories that you tell. I was appalled when I heard you say you were running out of stories from Ohio. If I wasn't a knower, some of these would be that, just stories, almost unbelievable. But once I moved out of town, man, have I been schooled. This happened in southern Trumbull County. I am a U.S. Army veteran, and I live next to a military installation in northeast Ohio, not far from the Pennsylvania line. I've been a firefighter EMT, not to mention 20-plus years in the Department of Corrections and a deputy. I've made new missiles and dismantled older ordnance at the arsenal during Operation Desert Shield. My hometown is small town. I know every inch of this area from growing up in the 60s and 70s hunting and trapping. I heard stories, but didn't believe of myths and stories. All of the town is surrounded by woods. Patches run clear to the bottom of the Appalachian Mountains. Minerva and the Salt Fork State Park is just south of us. Moved into the outskirts of town a few years ago. A large sawmill ran in the 80 acres of woods that butt up to the new house, but it had shut down and sold off and hadn't been running for years. I loved sitting on my back porch, just listening to the sounds of the night in the woods. Some I've never heard before, but wrote them off as coyotes or other sounds that carry through the woods. One night, I heard a blood-curdling scream right behind the garage, sent shivers down my spine. Again, I wrote it off as the loudest I've ever heard a critter getting snatched up by an owl or something. Fall of 2018. But still having thick green foliage. Must have been the end of September. Then it started, while on my way to town about 02:30 hours to pick up my son from work. I backed out of my drive, drove to the end of my property. Once I turned, my lights lit up a thing larger than I've ever seen in my entire life. It immediately turned from my lights and disappeared into the foliage, but I never saw a branch move. The being, as I called them, was approximately 3.5 to 4 feet wide at the shoulders, shoulder muscles the size of good-sized watermelons, rippling back muscles, but not a large head unless it was ducking, little to no neck, covered in long reddish-brown hair with shards of black in it, kind of like a shepherd's coat and hippie hair combined. I only saw it from waist up. As my car passed it within feet, I couldn't see out the windows 'cause it's dark in the woods. I floored the car to the end of the road, called my wife, and told her to secure the house. She didn't ask questions because of my work history. She locks and loads as good as I. I told her about it, and she just laughed. Thought I was messing around. No one would believe me. I talked to BFRO, and then a couple of guys met me at the house, and I showed them where it happened. There was no sign. So I got the feeling that they were skeptical, too. It got so bad, I thought I was losing my mind. I fought evil at its worst. This can't be happening. About a week later, I drove down the road as always. There it stood. I could see it. Big X that was freshly put up just 30 foot from the road. 20-foot-long logs literally woven between two larger trees, making the X approximately 15 feet in the air. I got the message loud and clear. Don't go back there. But then night after night, I sat on the porch, wondering. I knew when they were out there. It was like they were trying to talk to me mentally, but I felt no harm. I would start to get headaches at times, and I would go inside. One of those nights on the porch, I heard wood knocks 35 yards to my east, close to the X. I heard a large thump that shook my chair from the northeast, and three heavy steps that were loud and then stopped about 90 feet from me. I then heard knocks farther back in the woods. Now I'm dealing with at least three. The smell was horrible, but at the time I blew it off as the open sewers. Then that feeling. I was scared, but slowly reached in the door and grabbed the double barrel. Didn't hear much after that. I went inside after close to an hour, just knowing that they were just out of my sight in the shadows. I think a younger one was the closest, watching from behind the garage. The elders were watching. I have too many experiences to write, but I'll leave you with this one. On the back porch again, as my son rounded the corner after he got home from work again. I was talking to the creatures that night. I felt no fear, and several copies of bird whistles and owls would answer me. Once my son walked in front of me, I stopped him. I told him not to be scared, but they were watching. I told him, don't yell loud. Talk low and ask them if they were watching. When he did, it sounded like a large tree was thrown through the woods, limbs breaking and a thump. I found that large 10-foot piece of a log the next day, thrown toward the direction of the house. Immediately after, we heard a noise as if a horse flutters his lips. My son turned and had a look like, they're your friends, not mine, and walked right in the house. I don't try to associate with them as much as possible, but still, strange things happen out of the blue. I found a golf ball in the yard that was dirty and stinky. I asked my son if it was his. He looked at it with wide eyes. He said, I hit that ball out over the trees after hitting it with a baseball bat. It ended back up to the house a few days later. Strange, huh? I've rambled enough. Feel free to share this with all of your followers. These kind of things go on still to this day. I guess if I don't bother them, they've backed off of bothering me. Thank you again, Nance. Keep on with our Buckeye buddies, some not as nice as others. Sincerely, your fan, Timothy, who's sharing to see if others had anything like that to share so we can learn, trying to find answers. When I was younger, we lived out of Hillsboro near Rocky Fork. This is the mid-1960s. It wasn't so crowded back then as it is now. Our house backed up to a farm. We knew that farming family. I was friends with their daughter. That farm was between us and where the park and lake was, and they had woods between them and the park, if that makes sense. From our house to their house was about a half mile or a little less as the crow flies across the fields. That's how we walked back and forth. It was shorter than walking the roadway around. So me and my friend used to walk back and forth between our houses all the time. They mostly had cattle that was penned up off to one side of the farm, but the part we walked through was the part used to grow their own feed corn. It was those fields we walked through. It was later than usual one night when I was walking to my house from hers. It was November. It was frosty cold. The feed corn had been cut long before this. I was walking home. It was cold, but no snow. The ground would crunch a little bit when you walked on it, though. I don't recall any moon giving light. It was dark. Darker than today's kind of dark if you stand out in a field. No light pollution back then. I heard something else crunching on the ground somewhere near me. I thought it was a deer that was picking through for leftover feed corn. I had seen them do it many times. I looked around, but it was too dark to see. The only thing I could see was the lights from the house I'd come from way off in the distance, and the lights of the house I was going to, which was mine, still far away, but not quite so far. I still wasn't worried. I just figured deer. I started walking again. But the other crunching started again, too. I turned around fast and looked all around. I was suddenly disoriented because I couldn't see the house lights that were supposed to be right behind me, the ones I had just seen a moment ago. And that's when I knew something was standing there blocking the light. It still could have been a deer, though I had never had one follow me before. I stood there shocked and quiet for just a second, and then I heard something breathing, and it wasn't far away. That ain't no deer, I thought. I was scared right out of my boots. I started to see all kinds of shapes in the dark, but I don't know if they were real or not. Could have been my eyes and the fear working together just to scare me. I turned and started running. Now that's not easy in a worked field, by the way. Either you're hitting debris that hasn't been plowed under completely, or you're sliding through mounds of turned-up dirt on the rows. It's not a flat field, but I was tearing through it. I heard heavy stomps behind me. I heard loud breathing, and I believed that whatever it was right on my heels. I thought I was going to be knocked down or grabbed or something. I was running for my life at that point. I really believed that. Could have been a crazy axe killer, I thought. I didn't know. Now today, a teenager could probably have lots more scary boogeymen to choose from in their head. But in the 1960s, the worst I could think of was an axe killer. I was getting really close to my house. The light was getting bigger. And I started yelling and screaming, hoping my mom or dad would hear me. In just a second, I saw my dad come flying out onto the back porch, and he's yelling for me. I knew he couldn't see me. He's standing up there on a lit-up porch, trying to look out into darkness. At the same time, my feet felt flat under them. That meant I had left the field, and I hit our yard, which was mowed grass. So not far to the house now. That is when I felt a terrific whack to my right arm and side, like something just reached up and knocked the tar right out of me as hard as it could. All I knew is I was knocked sideways and went straight down. I felt like I'd been hit by a car. I had the wind knocked out of my lungs. I heard my dad yelling for me, but I couldn't scream. I had no air. I just couldn't get air in my lungs. It was dark, but I knew something walked right over me. I felt the air move, and I felt the ground and the vibrations when it stepped around. Then it stopped after it walked right past me. It just stood there, not far from where my head was. I could hear it breathing. Then it was walking away. My dad had a flashlight, and he was now shining it all around. I saw it flash over dark fur moving away as he came closer to me. And I know my dad saw it too, because he started yelling wildly. Now I had air in my lungs, and I let him know that I was right there, but to look down. I was trying to get up off the ground when he made it over to me. We got inside. I don't remember much beyond that. I do remember sitting at the table, telling him and Mom what happened after I could talk. There was lots that went on. He called our neighbor and told him and all sorts of stuff. None of that's important, because nothing ever happened, and we never saw it again. Just that when either of us girls wanted to walk to the other's house, one of the adults would drive us around in a car. Now, all the adults tried to pass it off to us as just some stray black bear. But I don't think that I could have possibly outran a bear out in that field. And I never believed that it would follow me, knock me down, and then walk off. And it was not what I saw in that fraction of a second in the flashlight. No way. And I don't think that my dad thought it was a bear either, though that is what he would say whenever anyone asked him about it or if he and I talked about it, right up till the day he died. But I know he didn't believe it was a bear either. I knew my dad. Nance, I don't know if it was out there just scouting for feed corn like all the deer did. I don't know if it thought I was butting in on its feeding grounds or that I was some kind of a threat or what. I do think certain that if it wanted to hurt me or snatch me up and take me off, it could have. Being chased across and out of the field and that slap and being knocked down, those were warnings of some kind, and I took them. I never once walked across those fields for the rest of the time that I lived there. Thanks for letting me tell all this, Rochelle. The two encounters I had were with the same friend of mine. Both occurred toward the end of June or early July in two different years. Both encounters happened in Michigan. The second encounter was not far from the Ohio line. Our first encounter happened while on a weekend canoeing trip on the O'Sable River in 2007. We had decided to go in June, and the weather was perfect. The trip was going great. We stopped at a great open part of the river for lunch. We got to see a few bald eagles and some deer drinking along the riverbank. Continuing down the river for a couple more hours, we decided to find a place to camp for the night. The location which we wanted to stop at first, we accidentally went past. My friend had been down the river many times with his father, so he knew there were a few locations ahead of us that we could stop at. We found a place that had a high bank on the right side of the river. It was a little harder to pull the canoe up, but the spot was perfect. It had spots for our tent and a fireplace made out of stone someone had built previously. Not shortly after pulling the canoe up and unloading our gear, we began to hear movement on the other side of the river. Nothing too crazy, just a few sticks breaking and something moving in the leaves. We chalked it up as a deer or a pheasant, maybe a rabbit or a squirrel. We unloaded all of our gear and began collecting firewood. I remember I had just opened a beer, and I was standing on the bank looking at the river, which was about 40 feet across, when I saw something make a small splash in the water. My first thought was that it was just some fish hunting insects, as it was dusk at this point. We kept setting up camp, getting everything ready for the night. But then the splashing became more prevalent. That's when I realized it wasn't fish jumping. Something was throwing rocks into the river. At first, I thought it was my buddy trying to play a joke on me to freak me out. But when I turned to my left, I realized he was standing next to me, also looking at the river. He had just turned around to go back to the fire when a huge rock about the size of a bowling ball was thrown out of the woods on the other side of the river, landing almost directly in the middle. The rock hit with such force that it hit the rocks on the riverbed and made a horrible clacking sound. Along with a huge splash, we both jumped as it scared the crap out of both of us. I immediately turned on my flashlight to see if someone was on the other side of the river. But nothing. No eyeshine. No movement. Nothing. Complete silence. The rock that it threw had to weigh a good 30 pounds, if not more, and it threw it from beyond the tree line. I don't think even an Olympic athlete could do that. After that, things calmed down, and the regular noises of the forest came back. There were no more rocks being thrown, nothing. But let me tell you, we didn't get much sleep that night. The next morning, we talked about it a little, trying to figure out what it could have been. Our only explanation was a Sasquatch. A human couldn't have thrown that rock, and the only way to access the area was by canoe, and we had only seen one other family on the river that day. That was earlier in the day, miles back down the river. We packed everything up and got out of there pretty quickly. That was my first encounter, but it would not prepare me for my second. The second encounter happened around the same time of year, late June or early July 2012. I was living in the Upper Peninsula at the time while my wife was finishing college. We would come downstate every winter and every summer for a couple weeks to catch up with friends and see the family. I had called my friend earlier in the day and asked him if he wanted to get together and maybe have a beer. He said sure. He said his parents had just got two brand new mountain bikes. Wondered if I wanted to go for a ride. The town where I'm from, which he lives in, is a small town, maybe only 2,500 people. There isn't much to do in town, so we decided to grab some beers and some snacks and head out to a preserve, which is just outside of town. It was about a 3-mile ride on a bike. When we headed out, it was about 10 at night, but both of the bikes had headlights, and there was no one on the roads, especially the back roads. When we got to the nature preserve, we decided to leave the bikes at the trailhead in the weeds so no one would see them. There is a long boardwalk through the swamp to get to the trail that leads to the river, which is the very back of the nature preserve. On the right side of the trail is a sheep farm, and they have other animals like donkeys and peacocks, a few cows, and a horse. Usually at night when we go out there, you can hear the animals, but this night they were all quiet. When we got to the river, there is a wooden porch. I'd say it's just a square with railings and benches to sit on by the river. We settled down our backpacks and decided to just look at the river for a little bit. Now at this time, we had kind of forgotten about our other experience on the O'Sable River. Since we'd never seen or heard anything, it just kind of got written off as something mysterious. I'd say we had been sitting back there for maybe a half hour or so, when again we started to hear noises like animals moving around in the brush, approximately 50 yards on the other side of the river. Now the side of the river we were on just had a row of trees right by the river, maybe 20 feet from the bank to the fields, and that had been turned into the preserve. But the other side of the river had never been farmed, or cleared for that matter. But there was an old railroad line that ran through years and years ago. But other than that, there wasn't anything on that side of the river. Again, we just shrugged the noises off as deer, since there are thousands of them around here. The noises kind of died off for a little bit, and we actually made a joke that it was a Bigfoot, and we started making goofy calls like the ones you hear on TV, the howls and just messing around. Then the noises became much louder, like this thing was causing a ruckus in the area it was in, breaking branches, rustling leaves, and making stomping noises. Right then I was like, it's a buck. But the noises were too loud for a deer, and we don't have bears around here. My next thought was, it was a cow that had gotten out and got tangled up in something. Me and my friend just kind of looked at each other like, what the heck is that? The creature had not moved any closer to us up to that point. But when we stopped listening and started talking again, it made a slight advance toward us through the brush, maybe 10 to 15 feet. At this point, we both started to get a little apprehensive. I know the woods very well. I was raised in the country, grew up hunting and fishing. I am familiar with the animal in the woods anywhere in Michigan. But in my experience, I have never encountered a creature this big in the woods. Not the way this thing sounded. It sounded huge, and it sounded pissed. My buddy said, "You think we should get out of here?" But at this point, I wasn't sure. I didn't know what the thing was. I knew we had the river between us and it. The river was high that year, probably about 5 feet in the middle, and the water was running very swiftly. I had crossed the river many times there and knew it wasn't easy. I figured, as long as that thing stays on its side and we stay on our side, we're fine. Boy, was I wrong. About that time, the thing charged. This time, it sounded like a freight train coming through the woods. Trees the size of my leg were being broken, just snapped off. You could hear this thing just plowing through the woods. At the time, all I had with us was a little LED flashlight. I shined the light across the river, and right about when I turned down my light, the thing stopped about 20 feet into the trees. We couldn't see anything. No eye shine, nothing. But we could hear the creature moving around still. It sounded like it was almost pacing back and forth. We picked up everything and threw it in the backpack, and I said, "Let's get the heck out of here." At this point, we were both scared, because this thing wasn't scared of us at all. As we were walking through the 10 to 15 feet of wood to get back to the trail, we could hear the thing walking closer to the riverbank. So we picked up our pace a little, but we didn't get far. Maybe 20 feet into the field with the trail on the left. The creature crossed the river in 2 to 3 strides. You could hear it splashing as it did. At this point, we went into survival mode. We had no weapons, so we went to the edge of the field where the trail was and grabbed sticks, the biggest ones we could find on the ground. We have a little time to turn around and look back at the tree line when this creature let out the most horrible scream I've ever heard in my life. It's really hard to describe. It's not like the ones you hear on TV. This sounded like it had 3 different parts to it, 3 different sounds, and 1 roar or scream. There was a deep, guttural growl mixed with a higher tone, then a short or mid-range moaning sound. But it all came out as 1 roar. We both froze with fear. The amplitude of the roar sent shockwaves through our body. You could feel it reverberating inside you. At this point, the creature was just inside the tree line, maybe 20 yards to our left and about 30 feet in front of us. The way the moon was shining that night, I could see the silhouette of the animal, but I couldn't see the details. But I knew the tree that it was standing next to. It was looking over the branch, which is where my head would be. I'm 6 foot, and the branch was at about this thing's pecs. Part of it was behind the tree still. I'd say maybe 3/4 of it was exposed on the right side of the tree. We didn't know what to do. We were standing in the middle of a field with sticks, and a giant creature was less than 50 feet in front of us, and it was pissed. The chest on it would have been equivalent of us two standing side by side. It never came any closer, and we didn't move. We just stared at each other. And this is the part of the story that is really crazy. I know that's probably not the right word to use, but it is. If I wouldn't have been with my friend and had him experience this too, I don't think I would have believed someone if they would have told me this. So we have been staring at this Sasquatch for maybe 30 seconds when to our right, on the other side of the fence, which would be on these people's property on their farm, a military fighter jet flew over us. It wasn't going very fast. It was maybe 600 feet off the ground. We could barely believe what was going on. Not only do we have this creature in the woods, but now there are military planes flying over us. I grew up in that town, lived there for 30 years of my life, never seen a military plane fly over, unless it was for race weekend at MIS or a flyover for a sporting event in Detroit. There aren't even any military bases in that area that house fighter jets. The first jet went over flying east and then banked slightly south when it got about 5 miles away from us. So now we're kind of tilted, looking over our shoulder and where these planes are flying, and we're trying to look down into the woods where this creature is at the same time. Before we could realize what was going on, another fighter jet flew over. This time it was a little closer to us, a little closer to the fence, and it was lower to the ground. But it flew in the same pattern as it went over us as the other plane had taken. At this point, my brain was overloaded. I was just trying to take all of this in. I just wanted to sit by the river and drink a beer and talk to an old friend. But no, something I could never even imagine is happening to me, and I have no idea what to do. Then something even crazier happened. The third jet that flew over was right on the tree line, and I'm guessing this was actually the first jet, that there were two of them. It actually came to a stop above the fence line, over the trees, right by the little porch we have been sitting on. And it was only about 100 feet off the ground, just above the trees. So we're looking up at a fighter jet, which you can clearly see because it's all lit up. It stopped and hovered for maybe 10 seconds before turning on 3 giant searchlights on the bottom of it. One was pointed onto the farmer's property. One was pointed in the trees, kind of where the creature was. And the other one was pointed back behind the plane, kind of on the other side of the river, almost in the woods. I remember looking at the plane and then looking back at the wood and not seeing the creature anymore. And then about that same time, we could hear it go on back across the river, running at the same speed it was when it came toward us. The plane sat and hovered above us for maybe 3 minutes in that same spot, not moving. And what's really weird is it was really quiet. Not like what you would think a jet would sound like. This thing was very quiet for its size. After about 3 minutes, the plane turned off the spotlights and began to slowly take off, following the same flight pattern as before. Just as it started to bank south, another plane flew over us to our left, at about 600 feet in the air. Again, it flew to the east and banked to the south. About 2 minutes later, another went by, farther to our left. At this point, we were still frozen, just trying to figure out what the heck was going on, and what had we just walked into? I looked over at my friend and said, "Let's go, now." He seemed to be thinking the same thing. We both got on the trail and just ran. I don't think I've ever ran that fast. We got to the bikes and started riding back, asking each other, "What was that? What just happened? Did you see that? Did you hear that? What was that thing? And why is the military out here?" The whole while, I was freaked out every time we came up to a wooded area that we had to ride by. I kept thinking that thing was going to jump out. We made it home, tired, and in a hurry. We still talk about it to this day. I still go out to that place, just not anymore at night. I learned 2 things that night. Sasquatch is a living, breathing creature, and the government knows they exist. This all took place in Manchester, Michigan, on the River Raisin. My guess is, they use the rivers for transportation just like we use road systems. If anybody out there has heard that same scream with 3 different parts, I would love to know. I love your show. Keep doing what you're doing. Steve from Michigan. I live west of McConnellsville, but work in the town. Most of my drive into town has me passing open fields, wooded areas, houses, and some farms. I also usually see lots of deer. November 2017, about 6:15 a.m. In November, that's dark. I was driving into town for work. I was going through where there are lots of trees and bushes on both sides of the road. There is a guardrail on the right side. There the land drops away from the road and you mostly see just the top half of the trees. There was a car up ahead of me. I don't know how far. I could see its taillights, but I wasn't close to it. Speed limit there was 55, but we were doing a little bit more. I had been paced evenly from that other car for a couple of miles, so I noticed when their brake lights up ahead of me flashed a couple times, like they were tapping their brakes. I thought it was probably deer or a rabbit or something up there that they didn't want to hit. That happens a lot out on these roads in the dark right before sunrise. You gotta be careful. I saw the small flashes of the brake lights, and then I saw that the brake lights suddenly seemed farther away. Huh, I thought, that means they've sped up. I only mildly really thought about it, but I didn't think about it in enough time. A few seconds later, I'm where they were when they were flashing their brake lights. As I come up there, I'm seeing it's the guardrail on that side. There's room to walk past the guardrail, but just a thin piece. I was looking out over there in case of more deer trying to cross or whatever the car had seen. And I almost didn't see it because it was so dark that morning. I was expecting to see and was looking for something light-colored, like a deer. I only realized it as I came up even to it, and I looked over at it as I was passing it. Now this would sound crazy to anyone but you and the people that follow your show. But I saw a Bigfoot standing there. It was standing on the thin piece on the other side of the guardrail. I drove by it pretty fast, so there wasn't a lot of time to look at it. My headlights showed it clear, though, before I got all the way past it. Massive. That's the only word I can think to use. I'm not even going to try to guess how tall. First, because I'm not good at that kind of thing, and it's hard since I was sitting down. But when I passed it, what I would call the upper thigh and groin area is what would have been visible from the passenger side window if it hadn't been so dark, and if I had had a passenger. So that's pretty tall anyway, that's what I would say. And maybe the car ahead thought they were going to hit it, and that's why they were tapping their brakes, and then, at the last second, they saw what they were looking at and hit the gas pedal instead. Because that's what I did. But only after I had already passed the thing. I don't know why. I was gone from it. But my reaction was to stomp on the gas pedal. It never tried to grab me or hit my car or nothing else I've read about. It just waited. Like it was going to cross the street. But it knew better and to wait for the cars to pass first. So that's what I saw. Thanks, Trinity. Hi, Nance. My name is Steve, and I have known about Bigfoot since I can remember. I thought it was a monster that roamed around the country frightening people. I never thought much more about it than that. I never thought about it being a natural being living in the areas where people see them, especially here in Ohio. I heard about the Minerva Monster on the local news, a story about a Bigfoot doing the usual Bigfoot things. But I didn't think much about it, even though we had hunting property just 4 miles from where it was sighted. One day, in the fall of 1980, I guess, a friend and I were hunting on that property. I was hunting an orchard where I see pheasants, and my friend was checking out a stand of corn maybe 40 yards wide by 80 yards long that had been left standing through the fall. About 15 minutes later, he came to where I was hunting and told me there was something in the corn, and he wanted me to come check it out. So I did. When I got there, we both started down the rows. I had a 12-gauge using 6-shot. He had a 16-gauge using birdshot. Then all of a sudden, maybe 20 yards in front of us, the corn started thrashing wildly. So I got ready to fire, but nothing happened. Then the thrashing stopped, and all was quiet. That seemed odd. The thing didn't run, didn't attack, it just thrashed corn stalks. A few seconds later, I started advancing again, and the thrashing starts again. It seemed a bit more violent this time. I aimed at where the thrashing was being taken place and waited for whatever it was to do something, and the thrashing simply stopped. No growling, barking, or howling, just thrashing. The animal seemed big. I doubt I could have thrashed that violently, and being there were no other sounds, I could not think of any animal that would do that. So this got me curious. I told my friend to back out and go to the other side of the field and to see what it was in case it came out that way. When he was in place, I again advanced, and again the thrashing started, even more violent than previously. I decided to come in another way, from the side, not down the rows. The weird thing is, if I went backwards or to the side, it didn't thrash. Only when I got so close and advanced on its position did it thrash. I did get within 15 yards or so from it, trying to see the hooves or paws or whatever on the ground. But I just could not see anything, just shadow. Basically, I came to the conclusion that it had to be a wild or escaped boar, because nothing else I've seen in the woods would act like that. And I don't know much about boar. They aren't in my area of Ohio. Therefore, I figured I had better not anger it, because my birdshot would not be sufficient to stop it from running me down, and a shotgun wound may actually make it more dangerous. So I backed out and left it alone. It wasn't until 35 or so years later, when I was listening to Bigfoot Encounters, that I realized that thrashing of vegetation was a Bigfoot trait. So now I'm thinking that there was a Bigfoot eating the corn, probably a young one that wasn't too keen on getting shot, but didn't know what else to do. I'll always regret not getting just a bit closer so I could get a glimpse of the creature. That property was sold, and I live in a more rural area now, and I hear very strange howls, much like a cow mooing at first, and then turning into a scream or sorts, lasting 10 or so seconds. There are a lot of cattle around here, and I think they mimic them. Many times the howl is a half mile away, but a few times in the night it was just 100 yards away and in a place where cows aren't present. I shoot every day, and my dog would follow me every time until about 3 years ago. Then she would smell the breeze and either follow or turn tail and go right back into the house. She is getting a bit too old to follow me now, but she still will come with me far enough to test the breeze, and sometimes follow. I'm pretty sure you had an encounter on your channel that is right down the street from me. All the elements lead me to believe there is a Bigfoot clan near, and they aren't so shy. I think my gunshots keep them a good distance from my property, especially if they've seen me shoot steel at 300 yards or so and realize I can hit them from afar. Love your show. I listen every night as I fall asleep. Keep up the good work. Hello, Nance. It's Nathaniel again. Hope all is well in your neck of the woods. I know my family in Ohio is locked down, but luckily here in Florida, we aren't. Otherwise, I wouldn't have gotten to go hunting and had this experience. I told you, if anything happened while hunting this year, I'd let you know. Well, this one is bizarre, so here we go. March 21st, 2020. Ask any hunter, opening day is like being a little kid on Christmas. So I went to bed early, but was up before my alarm. I loaded up my gear, made my coffee, and was off. As I'm pulling out to the main road, I glanced at my gauges and see that I forgot to get gas yesterday. No biggie, right? I hit the Circle K and filled up and went to get a few drinks. Being in full camo, it's somewhat obvious what I'm doing, and not everyone is a fan of hunters. And that's okay, as long as they aren't dicks about it. Well, the girl behind the counter took one look at me walking up and started walking away. She leaned into the back room and told someone to come ring me up. A guy looking annoyed walks out, looks at me, and then at her, and goes, "What's the problem?" Her answer was, "He's a hunter." The guy shook his head, and when he got to me, apologized. Me being a smart butt said, It's okay. I'm used to getting crap from people, and as long as ignorance wasn't contagious, I'd be fine. He busted out laughing. The girl watching us stocking the cigarettes turned bright red and quickly disappeared into the back. Back out on the road, and I hit every red light out of town. Finally, I made it to the Green Swamp Wildlife Management Area. The gates open, so I pull up to the check station and wait for my quota slip. And wait, and wait. Finally, after what felt like an eternity, the guy running the station walks up to me from the camping area and says, "We aren't handing out papers today because of the virus, so just head on in." So I book it. It's already 6:15 a.m., and I need to get to my spot. It's so foggy I can barely see the road and can only make out the name signs for the road. They aren't like a street sign. They're just pieces of wood painted white with the name of the road on it, and not real easy to see in the fog. Long story short, I made a couple wrong turns and couldn't figure out what dang road I was on. But I decided I'd wasted enough time dealing with the fog, and I picked a random spot. It was an area that had been burned recently. I walked in and set up on the edge of the field in a fire ditch with a big pine to put my back against. As the sun came up, just like every other year, it was a thing of beauty. And the gobbles from a roosted bird take it to a new level. Side note. Now, I know that a lot of people are probably thinking I'm insane or have a death wish after everything I've been through out there. And I can assure you I am sane and definitely enjoy living. I just love being in the wild, and I respect nature. I also know if the beings that live here want to harm me or kill me, well, folks, they could, be it bear, panther, or Bigfoot, especially the Bigfoot. They rule these woods, and I'm just a visitor. So I set up and called and was instantly gobbled at. This went on for a few hours. Finally, after getting nowhere with this bird, I switched my tactics, figuring he was henned up. I did my best to get that hen mad at me, and it worked. Half an hour after I started trying to tick her off, I hear a gobble directly behind me. So I peek around my tree, and there stands the hen 30 yards away with a Jake trying his best to look big. I'm on cloud nine. As I put the bead of my shotgun on this Jake, a huge tom dropped down on him. I was beside myself. The Jake bolted away from this tom, and the old tom went into full strut. I aimed and took my shot, and he dropped. I rushed over to my bird and did something most hunters will give me crap for. I knelt down beside him and gently placed my hand on his back and said a prayer of thanks to God and to the turkey. This bird was the culmination of many years of hunting and leaving empty-handed. He was the physical manifestation of my hard work and dedication to hunting this area. In other words, he was something beyond special. As I stood and lifted my bird up, I excitedly said, "Heck yeah!" And then I heard it, something I've never heard out there. I heard what sounded like singing from the woodline. It was deep and guttural, but oddly beautiful. It had tone and pitch. I could make out different words, but didn't understand them. The singing got louder and was joined by what sounded like what I can only describe as a didgeridoo. The weird thing was, I didn't feel scared. I didn't want to run. It felt like something was celebrating with me. Then it clicked in my head what was happening. I knew what was singing and knew it was closer than I was comfortable with. I didn't want to be rude or offend the band for fear of angering them. So I just said, "That was beautiful. Thank you very much, but I have to go." And I made my way back to the truck, walking as quickly as I could with my gear and my bird. When I got home with my bird, my son was kicking himself for not going with me, especially since I'm done for the season now. My bird weighed just shy of 25 pounds, had a 9-inch beard and was missing one of his 1.5-inch spurs. It's a hunt I'll never forget. Not just because of my bird, but because of that singing. Maybe they don't hate me after all. Or maybe the other times I had been too close to their family. The one time I was definitely too close to their food. This experience has definitely shown me that these things are more than just wild animals driven by instinct. But it increased my respect for them, as anything that seemingly celebrates a successful hunt and doesn't challenge you for your kill, that's intelligent and social. I hope from now on, this is the only kind of interaction I have with them when I go out turkey hunting. Well, Nance, that's my story from this year's hunt. Thank you for reading. And thank you and everyone who commented on my first email for all the support. It helped me a lot. Thank you again, Nathaniel. Greetings, Nance. Now, I've never submitted a story before, so I hope this is a good story for your channel. Before I start, I want to say this encounter is rather short, and I was a very young child at the time, so I can't remember all the details very vividly. This sighting was in Eatonville, Washington, and was probably around 2008 or 2009. I don't quite remember due to how young I was. There is a wildlife park there called Northwest Trek, and it is kind of like a zoo. However, there is a bus tour that takes you deep into the forest and wilderness to see the local wildlife. This is a large area that is fenced off, but as they say on the tour, it's pretty easy for animals to get in and out every now and then. Me, my sister, and my grandmother would be going on this tour. I love this tour, and I still do, since you always see such magnificent animals. Anyway, as the tour had entered a forested area, we had just passed a group of elk. They were very impressive, with a large bull and a group of females. About 2 minutes after we passed the elk, I was looking out the window, trying to see some more animals. I wanted to see a moose. But there was one stump that caught my eye. This stump was probably about 4 feet tall. Now, I remember looking at this stump and seeing what I thought at the time was a baby gorilla. I remember him peeking at the bus, looking right at me from behind the stump, with one hand visible, grabbing the stump. It sort of reminded me of a cartoon character looking around a wall. I turned to my grandmother and excitedly told her, "Grandma, I just saw a baby gorilla." I didn't know at the time that this was a tour of local wildlife. I was a little kid, so I thought I had seen a baby gorilla. She looked rather confused and said that there were no gorillas in Washington. Keep in mind this was a wildlife park, not a zoo. I looked back at the quote-unquote gorilla and the stump, and I could now see part of its torso. It was still looking at the bus before it crawled behind to another part of the stump, hiding from view. From what I remember, he was probably about 3 feet or 3.5 feet tall. He either had black or dark brown fur and a rather gorilla-like face, although I remember the eyes being almost like a person's, with light green or brown eyes and a pupil. His wide nose pointed out a little bit more than a gorilla's, but not a lot. He had a bare face, but I can't remember what the skin's color was. Now, these physical traits might be different from the adults, since he was a baby, and I never saw an adult. It wasn't until a few years later that I remembered this event and realized that I probably saw a baby Bigfoot. I am 14 now and love researching all that I can about this mysterious species of apes. My theory is that a female Bigfoot had come into this area to forage for food and had left her baby hidden by this stump. I don't know if this is realistic Sasquatch behavior, but we don't know too much about them. To this day, I wish more than ever to see or even hear, but hopefully not smell, a full-grown Sasquatch. I live in a more suburban area, so this is the only sighting that I've had. I'll let you know if I ever see the Kings of the Forest again. Thanks for reading, Finn. Hi there. Just got a quick one to tell you, Nance. I spent lots of time at my grandparents in South Salem, Ohio, when I was a kid. This would have been the late 1980s. Small place, nice people. In the hot summer, a cool shady creek drew us young boys like moths to a candle in the darkness. Our creek was Buckskin Creek, but we just called it the Buck. One day, me and the two boys that I had made friends with during my summer stays at my grandparents' headed down to the Buck. Sometimes we caught crawdads. Mostly, we just hung under the shade of the trees that lined the creek bank and poked around in the dirt and the mud, turned over rocks, and watched minnows swim around our feet in the water. Now, that doesn't sound like all kinds of fun now, but it was what we had then. No computers or nothing of the like. And I'd give anything to relive one of those summer days again. I'm getting away from my topic. Sorry. So that day, the creek was pretty low. It had been hot and dry lately. We needed rain bad. We were sitting in the creek, all three of us boys. Where we were sitting, there was just enough water to come up 3 or 4 inches on us. There were some spots of the creek that were a bit deeper, but the creek was pretty skimpy at the spot we were in. We were just sitting there, shorts and all being wet. None of us had pools, and this was the next best thing, just getting wet, sitting in the creek in the shade, and hoping for a breeze. We weren't doing anything, just talking and carrying on like boys do. We heard something splashing up around the curve of the creek. It was a ways off, but we heard it plain, all three of us. We stopped talking and listened. The splashing wasn't very unusual. In the summer, we often saw animals at the creek, sometimes even in the middle of the day when they would normally not be there. We even saw deer sometimes in the late afternoon. They must have been very desperate for water. But what we heard, it was nothing of the size like we heard then. This wasn't a delicate picking through the creek with hooves like some deer would do. And a deer was the largest animal that I knew to look for out there at that time. But what we heard was a bigger, chunkier sounding splash. We all three looked at each other and waited. Then it came into view. A large, hairy animal. And that's all I knew to call it at the time. It was just a big animal. But it was walking on 2 feet. It looked black to me, but later on one of the other boys insisted that it was just a dark brown, so I don't know. I didn't know how to guess height then. I just saw that it was tall, really taller than any of the adults I knew at that time. And it was really big, too, side to side, which scared me. It was looking down while walking, like looking for something in the water, which I thought was odd since it wasn't trying to not splash, which would obviously scare anything in the water that it was looking for. We watched it for a few seconds more. We all knew this wasn't something that we wanted to have walk up on us as we sat there. It was still a bit down the way, where the bend of the creek curves back to straighten out where we were. And I don't know which one of us, but one of us got up first, and then we all got up. We got up to the bank and ran. Normally, we cut around the cemetery that stood between where we lived and the Buck. But not that day. We tore through that cemetery like our rear ends were on fire. I don't think it saw us until we got up and started running. I saw it look up and over our way as we were exiting the creek area. We tried to tell my friend's father, who was home at the time. I don't know what he thought, but he just told us, "Don't go back to the creek then." Like, that's it. That just made it all better for us. Problem solved. We three decided that we saw a Bigfoot. And nobody believed us boys, and we did try to tell people. We still went down to the creek, but we didn't see it again. Thank you for telling my story, Bob. Hi there. I really enjoy listening to the storytelling. It's fun to put on the headphones and just putter about and follow a tale. I'm 61. Growing up in Oregon and the Pacific Northwest, there were rumors and jokes about Sasquatch. Not often, but sometimes mentioned in passing as an aside or humor. It was held privately if you saw one. Partly because you'd be called crazy, But with all the logging and mining back in the day in the vast forested Pacific Northwest, it had to be common. In the 1924 Ape Canyon encounter by the miners in the cabin by Mount St. Helens in Washington, next door to Oregon, had been carried by various newspapers. It's still called Ape Canyon today, almost 100 years later. But not until recent years have more people in the region shared their stories publicly. My brother not long ago shared a story with me from his close friend about a Boy Scout troop that he was in. This friend was camping at a high alpine lake in the Oregon Cascades in the early 1980s. I had camped at this lake a few years earlier in my own Boy Scout troop as well, so I know the area well and could visualize the forested campground at about 5,000 feet, trees, clear lake, and rocky hills around it in the shadow of Snowtop Mount Jefferson, which is 10,500 feet tall, one of Oregon's tall mountains. I trust my brother to share the truth. And now that we both have come into Bigfoot awareness, this story has many behaviors we now call typical, such as Sasquatch territorial displays, interest in children or young people, and gifting. It was confusing at the time, but now it makes sense. The troop of around 12 to 15 boys, ages 11 to 17, and 2 to 3 instructor leaders set up their tents and camped by the lake to kick off the scouting weekend. They made their dinner, and after dark, they were all sitting around the fire under the bright stars when there was a sudden crashing through the trees across the lake about 1/4 mile on the other side. While they couldn't see it, they heard a large animal running, grunting, and tearing off tree limbs. Crack, smash, pound of feet. The animal or creature made its way along the other side, a heavy creature pushing through the brush along the lake coming around the curve, closer to the troop. It got louder. The instructor said it was likely a bear, but everyone sensed something different. As concern rose, the creature's grunts and noise seemed to not come nearer, but rose higher, going up the rocky slope of pine, volcanic rocks, and bushes and such, above the lake. And it climbed up the slope, higher to the higher tree line, gradually, and the commotion gradually disappearing. Then it was quiet again. The leaders told the troop it was to be ignored, but nervously ended the fire and had the boys call it a night. The scouts and leaders all climbed in their sleeping bags in their tents and put their lights out. Just the beautiful silence of the high alpine night. Was it wise to stay camped there? It was just a bear, right? A few hours later, around 4 to 5 a.m., one of the instructors heard some noises near the camp, such as rustling or movement. When you're half asleep, your mind can tell you it's just a mouse or a couple of deer, or you're in a dream, and so on. A little later, about 5:30 a.m., the instructor crawled out of his tent in the early dawn with just enough light around the camp to walk to the Forest Service outhouse. He suddenly spotted something on a table by the tents. On the table was a mass of bones, a large pile of wet, red, dripping animal bones, lying in blood, such as eaten clean bones from a freshly killed deer or two. A bit of sinew and hooves were all that was left. The instructor, shocked, quickly woke up the troop leader. With a mind to the large animal running around the lake and this bizarre bloody bone pile, the leader told the instructors to quickly wake the boys, tell them to silently tear down, pack up, and jump in the rigs. In minutes, the rigs were packed, and they all drove out of the area. A Friday to Sunday weekend scout outing was shut down just the first morning, and fast. Was it a Sasquatch bothered that there were campers in his or her territory? Did it see that the scouts were young boys, ages 11 to 17, and decided to bring the bones as a gift? Who knows? My brother said it scared the troop completely, and the friend kept the story to himself for many years, deciding to get it off his chest to his close friend, my brother. Since this 1980s experience, I myself have personally heard solid, clear tree knocks at 3 in the morning at a high-altitude, remote backcountry area in the Oregon Cascades near our tent, maybe 100 yards. And finally, in the early 2000s, my mountain climbing friends and I heard a large bipedal animal heavily pounding its feet and breathing hard, stomping closer to within 30 feet by our two tents. Cracking sticks it was trampling or brushing against for 1 to 1.5 minutes at 2 in the morning at 6,500 feet on the flanks of the same Mount Jefferson near the earlier Scout Troop Lake as we bivouacked overnight in preparation to climb Mount Jefferson. It woke us up, but strangely, it didn't seem to bother us. We were wary, but it didn't create fear. I remember thinking at the time, it was telling me it's okay to be camped there. After a minute, it gradually tapered, and the creature stomped and breathed off into the forest and disappeared. It was like the creature was saying, "I see you here. I know you're here, and I'm going to leave. But I'm keeping an eye on you, humans." Well, that's what I have. Feel free to share as a story. Thanks for the chance to share. Signed, a regular listener in Portland, Oregon.
Hi, my name is Dan, and I never in my life could imagine that I would cross paths with a Bigfoot in the flatlands of Northwest Ohio. This incident happened face-to-face with me in 2013, but then realized it actually started in 2012. In 2013, I was wade fishing down the St. Mary's River in my deer hunting area, in which I could catch smallmouth bass and sogeyes. That year, we got a lot of rain, and what was knee-high water turned into waist-high. As I made my way down the river, I eventually ran into a deep spot, which caused me to turn back to find a spot to climb out and walk around the area because the banking there was 8 feet tall. When I made it around a bend, I found a spot to climb out. As I took a step towards the bank, a huge blow shot through the air that vibrated right through my body, causing every hair on my body to stand on end. This huge bush 10 yards from me shook vigorously. Then everything went quiet. I knew that at this moment that was not a deer, due to me being an avid deer hunter at the time. That blow would have come from one huge deer, and usually a deer will take off after blowing, but nothing happened. To shake this river brush like that would have taken every bit of 2 men, due to it being real dense and heavy wooded, which is very hard to shake. I then took another step, and the same thing happened with a little more intensity. So I stopped and tried to look as close as I could to try to see the beast, but to no avail. All my life I have been one of those people who are not afraid of facing my fears. So I took the third step, and oh my, the blow, and the bush I thought was going to be picked up right out of the ground. So I calmly turned and walked back in the direction that I came. Most people would have defecated their pants for how much rage the third step caused the creature. I got to the deep spot and threw my fishing gear up on the bank and pulled myself up the steep bank, crawling onto the floor of the woods on my belly, scanning the terrain for the Bigfoot. But nothing was there, so I started walking backwards out of the woods to where the road pinched off that section of the woods. I stayed clear of the woods and walked back to the owner's house without taking my eyes off the woods. I told the owner of the woods, but I don't know if he believed me. But I know that what I came across was a Bigfoot. I thought of the strange occurrences of the 2012 hunting season. One morning at 4:30 in my deer stand, about 10 deer came running down under my stand and didn't move away from me till a half hour from daylight. Following day, I moved to another stand by the river in which my back was facing the river. That whole morning, I was experiencing a lot of stuff falling into the river behind me, but couldn't see very far behind me due to the tree. And at the end of the season, my tree that was healthy and nothing wrong with was what I know now was pushed over with my deer stand in it, and the tree beside it
with nothing happening to it. To this day, I have never been back to the woods, and every time I drive by, I just shiver to the bone. Thank you for sharing my story. My wife and I said, we had to write to you because we heard your Blue Rock story first, and then later on, we heard the one about the bread guy heading to Duncan Falls. Those aren't that far from us. We've listened to you for a while, but those two, they sealed the deal for us. We live very near the Blue Rock Forest and Duncan Falls, somewhere in that triangle area. Boy, have we seen and heard some crazy stuff. We have a small plot, just a couple acres, so we don't have our own big piece of woods. But there's plenty enough nearby, and there's plenty enough that runs the back and the left of the property line. That's where it all happens. Many times, we've sat outside and we've heard strange noises coming from the trees, but that wasn't a problem. The first summer we lived here, we had a barbecue and had some family over. We are all sitting outside. There were 11 of us. Where we sit is about 200 feet from the nearest tree line. It's clear all the way from there to the trees. Then started rocks landing nearby. At first, I thought it was one of the troublesome teens in the group. But a quick look around, and I could account for all of the people there. There wasn't nobody that I couldn't see while this was happening. I just want to make that clear. This rock throwing lasted only a few seconds. Maybe 8 or 10 rocks total were thrown. But the rocks were about the size of a big man's fist, and they were coming all the way from the trees. We watched them. Now, I knew there aren't too many that can throw a rock weighing a couple pounds well over 200 feet. And they had a high arc on them, these rocks, like they had been wound up and thrown high. It didn't make no sense. Sometimes we heard these weird yowling screams. At the time, I was sure it was some kind of a cat, like a bobcat or a cougar. But at the same time, I wasn't so sure, because it didn't sound like no bobcat or cougar that I'd ever heard, and I'd heard a lot in my time. But life went on. We kind of forgot about the rocks and the weird noises at night. Those noises stopped by the fall. It was winter, bitter cold, no snow. We had come home late and had a late dinner. My wife loaded the dishwasher and was hand-washing her pots and pans in the sink. There's just a long over-the-sink light on, not the overhead kitchen light. So she's standing at the sink right under this light, washing. It's dark outside. Window right in front of her. She's all lit up. She said she started to feel uneasy, and she had this being watched thought. She didn't know why, but she looked up from the sink. At first, all she saw was her own reflection in the window, but then she saw movement and saw eyes shine. She said it looked yellow to her for just a second. It flashed and was gone. She screamed and ran out of the kitchen. Now, I figured that she was overworked and had just seen her reflection in the glass. I told her so at the time, and I assured her that the bottom of that window was just over 7 feet high from the ground. I know, 'cause I had to re-caulk it that year. I was on a ladder. I assured her that no person or animal could walk by and look in that window. We were sleeping one night when we heard a big thump on the house. It was loud enough that it brought us both awake. Now, our house sits out by itself. There ain't nothing close to it, no trees, and no road that someone would likely run their car off of and crash into the house or to the barn. We are set way back and away from the road. That's why we bought this place. But to me in my sleep, at first, it sounded like someone busted down a door or a tree fell on the house or something. Your mind plays all kinds of tricks of you when you're sleeping. But there wasn't anything busted, and when I came awake, I realized there are no trees close to the house. I did go out and have a look around the house after I got dressed and got my gun and a flashlight. But I never did find what did it, and I found nothing broken or destroyed. Frozen ground was still at that point, so there were no prints to be seen the next day either. But weird stuff would keep happening. We didn't make much of it at the time. It was all spread apart and over the next couple years, so we didn't put it together. We had lots of theories during that time of what it was, and we were able to explain each thing away on its own. In our minds, we had come to the conclusion that it was a certain neighbor who had a very bad reputation and was not the nicest of persons. But our minds got changed, however, when we caught sight of what it really was. We were coming home late one night after visiting some folks, and we were coming down Sugar Grove Road. It was dark. We were going through a stretch that has growth on both sides up close to the road. Now, Sugar Grove is a very narrow lane with not a lot of traffic. If you're ever looking for the proverbial country lane in Ohio, stretches of Sugar Grove fit the bill. I suddenly, as we went along, felt a bump to the rear of the truck, and it felt like the back of my truck fishtailed a bit, like it does when it's slick out and raining or snowing and icy with an empty bed. But it wasn't slick out. It was perfectly dry, and I knew I hadn't hit anything because the bump came only to the back. I didn't feel two bumps running over it, and it felt like it had come from the side to fishtail me. I stopped, wondering what the heck just happened. Had something fallen off my truck? And that's what my wife asked me, what was going on. I said, I don't know. I checked the mirrors, and I was looking through the back window, but view is limited because of the bed of the truck. But all I could see beyond it was red from the brakes. I didn't see anything in the road from what little I could see. I said, I should probably go look and see to make sure I didn't run over an animal and I'm leaving it half alive. That thought turned my stomach. I was unbuckling my seatbelt when there came another bump to the truck, stronger this time. Before I could look up to see what was going on, my wife is screaming her head off, and I'm all like, what, what? She's grabbing me and jerking my arm, at the same time punching it, just screaming for me to drive, 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 get out of here. Now, I didn't know what the heck had come over her. She'd never acted like this. I'm trying to figure it out, and that's when I see something out of her side of the truck. It was big, and it was walking along the side of the lane right next to the truck. As it came up to where I could see it, it kind of turned sideways, and as it walked by the hood of the truck, and I saw it clear when it walked up the lane and the headlights lit it up for good. The fur was shiny in the lights and was dark, black-looking. The fur didn't look stringy, and I didn't see any hanging anywhere. If it was a cat, I would say it was a short hair, not a long hair, if you get me. It was on two legs, and I saw the thick legs. It was blocky, with no waist indent. I saw the muscles in its back as it swung its long arms. It just kept walking. We had both fallen quiet, and we both just watched it. I didn't know whether to hit the gas and speed up and go past it or what. We were still just sitting still in the road. It would soon be out of headlight range, and that's when I decided the heck with it. I'm gunning it, and I'm getting past it. There wasn't no turning around on that narrow lane. There wasn't no way I was going to back that truck up a mile or more in the dark to where I maybe could turn around. So I gunned it. I veered over as far as I could to the driver's side of the lane, and I went for it. Now, my truck is a manual, so I'm shifting and doing all I can to get up to speed as fast as I can. That thing turned its body to look at us as we came toward it, and it started picking up speed right along with my truck. And for just a few seconds, it was running alongside of us and kept pace with us. I felt another bump on the tail of the truck as we finally picked up more speed and passed it by, and I felt the fishtail movement a bit again. But now we were picking up the speed, and we were leaving it behind in the darkness. I have never barreled down that lane like I did that night. I almost lost control of the truck in the curve that happens at Man's Fork, and I know this road well. I've driven it for over a decade. We were both shaken. We got home and we asked each other if we really saw that. And was that what I think it is? After a lot of discussion, disbelief, and looking, we both agree it was a Bigfoot. It was standing up on two legs. Long arms were swinging. It had black fur and a definitive cone head. My wife got a really good look at the face on her side when we passed it, she said. And she is certain that its face was more long and narrow than what we see depicted on the internet. And the head was very cone-headed. She looked mostly at the eye area, she said, and she is certain that that is what was at the window that night that she was washing up in the kitchen. It makes sense to me, considering how tall it was when it passed my truck. It could have easily reached and looked in to the kitchen window. And I didn't know much about them then, so we looked all kinds of stuff up, and now all the stuff makes sense. That was 2013. Since, we've had some limbs thrown at us from the trees, and we've heard more of those weird screams. It isn't consistent, but it does happen mostly in the spring and summer. And I'm not saying that the Bigfoot we saw that night is the same one around our house. We don't live on or near Sugar Grove. That whole thing that night happened several miles from our actual house. I'm just saying, I think there's more than one, and if not, well, a single one has a very large range of travel. The trees out by our house, like I said, aren't ours to go looking through. I did say something once to the man that owns it, but he's not a friendly type, and either he doesn't believe, or he believes and knows and doesn't care. I don't know which. We aren't scared or going to move away or anything. We're still here. In all the reading we've done about them, no one has been hurt or killed by one of them. Sure, it's possible. It's possible they have been killed and we don't know about it. But there's bobcats and mountain lions in those trees as well by our house. And I think they're probably more dangerous. And they ain't making me move. So neither is Bigfoot. Thanks, Colin. Phil took this report in February 2017. On about July 2000, Roy, Dawn, and their kids, who were about 12 years old, were camping near the Cook Dam about 10 miles west from Oscoda on the Osable River, Lasco County. It was a Sunday night, and in the dark about midnight, they heard something moving about their tent. The boys and a friend were in another tent. They had some supplies in paper bags and a screen part of the tent, and they could hear whatever moving the bags. Then they see something like a finger moving on top of the tent, about 8 to 10 feet up, and then the whole tent shook. Roy yelled at it and wanted to shoot it, but he would have ruined his tent and it ran away. But they could hear it moving back and forth in the woods away a bit. The family was scared and grabbed some of their stuff and left the campground. When they came back in the morning, they found a loaf of bread taken from the table and left along the trail, but not opened. Dawn saw the animal at one point and never wants to camp there again. Justin remembers his parents being very scared. In about 1989, Roy and his brother-in-law, Rick, were going to ice fish in February at daylight in Wigwam Bay along the Saginaw Bay, Aranac County. It was very swampy, but frozen as they walked toward the bay. Then, at a distance of maybe a quarter mile, they saw a being leaning over in the reeds. He and Rick waved to get its attention, and it stood up, and they could see whatever it was very large and bipedal, and it started running toward them. Due to its size, they figured it had to be 8 feet tall plus, with 4 feet wide shoulders and arms that hung to its knees. It scared them, and they turned around and ran back toward their truck. They were afraid it would catch them, it moved so rapidly. They returned to his sister-in-law's house, and she asked if they had seen a ghost. They were so shook up. They returned to the sighting area later with their 300 cal deer rifle, but found no tracks in the area. Also, in 1978, Roy was ice fishing with his friend Rick in February near Vanderbilt Park 1/4 mile out from Quantico Sea, about 10 miles east of Bay City, and toward the late evening, it was sleeting badly. And when they picked up their fishing equipment to leave, a being at least 7 to 8 feet tall followed them briefly. It was very swampy and marshy in that area. This report was recorded by Phil Shaw, West Branch Bigfoot researcher, and amended after a visit to the family with Bigfoot researchers Karen Anderson and Rick Brenner on Friday, February 10, 2020. Hello, I would like to tell you about my Bigfoot encounter, but I would like to be anonymous. I've only told 3 other people who I thought were trustworthy. I'm trying to become somewhat of a public figure, and I'm reluctant to share in the first place, just in case. I wouldn't want the reputation of being a bit nutty getting in the way of positive forward movement. I'm sure you can imagine the stress of that type of ridicule. This would impact my situation greatly. You'll know why later on in the story. However, I think I have to get this out and share my story. I live in a tiny cabin at the edge of a wooded swamp. It patches out along various farmers' fields where game animals can thrive. They trek back and forth close to the cabin as if the woodline is a funnel for their trails to meet. It would only make sense, at least in my mind, that predators would be on the fringe stalking their prey. The locals have game cams out that frequently pick up cougar, bear, and bobcat all the time. It's a testament to the volume of food they have available in the region. It's not too far of a stretch to see where some Sasquatch might be there as well. That is, unless you're skeptical, which you should be until enough evidence convinces you otherwise. However, the area has stories of these creatures dating back for centuries. It seems like a silent little secret that nobody wants to talk about openly. The locals have suppressed the stories in fear of ridicule. The indigenous tribes still remember and pass the legends on through their cultures, which is a good thing. There are a lot of strange things here, including the beginnings of several legends of cryptids, like the Dogman in which I live at Ground Zero, where it all began. For now, I'll stick to my story and try to have as much continuity as possible. I bought the cabin after becoming a disabled person and required a cheap place to live in peace. I decided to live near my family, where they could see me more and I would get help if a medical emergency came up, which it does quite often. I wasn't in the place for more than a few months when I got a dog from a friend who needed a good home. She was abused, in a bad spot, and needed some rescuing. It was a good deal for both of us, and there was a lot of love to share. One summer night, I had the windows open and was enjoying a slight breeze and the sounds of the night as I slept. About 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning, I awoke to a growl from the dog and then a whimper. I paid no attention as I thought there might be a thunderstorm approaching or some other mundane thing. I rolled over and took in a deep breath, thinking to myself how refreshing and peaceful my night was going to be. I was wrong, of course, because of the following. About a minute later, I heard what sounded like a couple of samurai warriors talking to each other. It startled me enough to sit up, turn, and place my feet on the floor. I listened for a little while as the conversation grew nearer. It sounded like they were at the corner of the road, just 200 feet away. I thought someone was messing around like drunks and poachers sometimes do in the middle of the night. The language sounded rough and foreign to me, yet seemed like a question-and-answer type of conversation. Unintelligible words, phrases, grunts, and snorts bellowed out and echoed in the area. The dog sprung a leak and pissed all over the house and squeezed under my bed. She was scared out of her wits, and I was getting mad about it. I yelled out, "Hey, shut up and get out of here. I'm calling the police." A few seconds went by, and everything was silent except for the shivering bones hitting the floor and bed from the dog. She squeezed under 3 inches of space, which amazed me, even though she made the bed flop as she went under it. That's when I heard a snort or grunt, then a loud voice saying what sounded like, "Oh, why?" It rattled the back window, like it usually did when a big truck would go by full of potatoes or beans. But the voice didn't have the upward inflection of asking a question, though. It was more of a commanding sound, full of anger. Then who, or whatever it was, stomped through the thick part of the wood line behind the house. They were breaking branches on their way through to the big woods behind the house. The sticks kept breaking, but faded out with distance increasing. It was over in just a couple of minutes, and I was almost frozen from the fact that I knew these were not humans. It wasn't until a half dozen or so years later that we saw one or two of them. I'm not so sure about the second one. I was walking the dog again, but this time just on the side of the road. We had 6 inches of slush that fell overnight, and I didn't feel like walking around getting soaked from the knees down, so we stuck to the road that day. I was trying to get both of us healthy by walking a lot. I was recovering from open-heart surgery and needed to keep moving and gain strength. Even though the morning was a little misty and foggy, you could see for a long way. It seemed to be holding near the ground like an old Vincent Price movie. We were almost home, just a couple hundred yards, in fact. The little hill we descended had pines on one side and hardwoods on the other. That's when I heard a branch break, then a low grunt or breath. I couldn't tell. My first thought was there was a bear in the ditch just out of hibernation. You know, when you go past planted red pines and you can see rows at a 45-degree angle? Well, that's what it was like, and there was one of the oddball white pines about 10 feet tall in the middle of the row, about 20 to 30 yards away. I was stunned to see a Bigfoot standing in front of the tree, like it was trying to blend in. It was 3/4 the size of the tree, but just as wide. I could see black and dark gray patchy fur all over except for its face. It looked like a pencil sketching. It was a little distance away, so the details couldn't be made out well. A little mist on my glasses obscured my vision as well, but not enough to where I was blind or seeing things from an active imagination. This was obvious and real. The dog and I must have walked past that same spot hundreds of times, and never had it looked like this. I stared at it for a few seconds and saw that it had a look of absolute rage in its eyes. You know, the kind of blackout rage that you see someone have with no consequences as they destroy everything in sight? Yeah, it was like that, and I didn't know what my best move was. I did, however, gather the strength to say, "Hello there," in the nicest way possible. I followed up with, "We're just passing through and going home. We mean no harm." It didn't move a muscle, not even a blink, and kept glaring. Just then the dog came to the end of her leash and was standing on her hind legs, choking herself. She was trying to get to something on the opposite side of the road. I didn't see anything personally. She seemed to, though, and was completely overcome with her instincts to go after it. I gave a little tug and said, "Come on, Athena, let's go home." When I looked back towards the creature, it was gone, and daylight shone through the tree onto the white of wet snow behind it. I looked left one more time to where the dog was concerned. "It's time to go," I said, and pulled her toward our home. She bolted in that direction and came to the end of the lead again, choking herself. I'll bet she caught a whiff of whatever it was and came to her senses, then changed her mind. She seemed scared now and couldn't wait to get back inside the house. That was the big stuff that day. But little stuff kept happening throughout the years, and even today. There are the typical wood knocks at night, and sometimes in the day I've been hit with pine cones from the side and behind me, where no pines grew. There was one summer where dead animals would show up under my bedroom window every other day for a month. There was once a toddler's neon green shoe sitting on a stump next to stacked rocks where we walked. I picked it up and moved it to another stump about a half mile away, deeper in the forest. I made sure it was far away from the typical human trails and roads. That way, it wouldn't be obvious to anyone cutting through the property, and they wouldn't pick it up. For some odd reason, it found its way to the neighbor's cabin, sitting on the porch when we finally got there. It was like something made a big circle around us just to get ahead. Then it left the obvious sign of an intelligence messing with us with the bright-colored shoe. Even though my little dog passed in the spring, I still go for walks once in a while for health reasons. It's quieter in the cabin now and a little lonelier. I do have something tapping on the side of my house every other night in the summer. It sounds like someone is knocking. So I get up, turn on the yard light, and then double-check all the locks. Then it's back to bed or sleeping in a recliner with a rifle close by. The loggers came in late summer to my surprise and took out half the forest around me and left big gaping trenches from the heavy equipment tires. The place looked horrible and tore up everywhere. Hundreds of acres of berry bushes were now mud pits that you have to run and leap over just to get through now. It breaks my heart to still be subject to the noise of human activity, even though I moved here to get away from all that. Since then, I've only heard one scream during my sunrise walk and what sounded like a couple of wood knocks in the distance. The Sasquatch appears to have moved on, and I don't blame them. I'm just grateful not to see another looking at me like it wanted to kill me or something. Now I am enjoying the quiet time when the traffic from the main road lulls at night. I can hear the tree frogs and other night creatures relaxing me into a better night's sleep often. I need the extra rest at the time of this writing due to my recent diagnosis. My team of doctors has informed me that I have but a few months till maybe a year to live. I won't share what the thing is called because even the doctors have a hard time saying it. I don't see the point of trying. Besides, it's a little too personal for me to share. The point is, while I fight to beat this thing, I feel this story needs to be told just so it doesn't get lost forever. I'll continue on writing my books and being a happy person right up to the end, which I hope is a long time from now. At some point, I would like answers about the Bigfoot people, and the truth is exposed to the public about them. It would bring me peace to see disclosure in my lifetime. That's my story, and I hope you found it interesting. I'm sending thoughts of happiness and love your way, and hope life treats you well. Signed, Harmonica Man. Bigfoot Sighting Report by John H. On about October 9th, 2015, I was walking my dog along Shrigley Road from Irons Park, West Branch, at about 8 p.m. in the evening, in the dark. My dog sensed something in the woods or swamp, and I stopped to look. About 20 paces away, two red eyes were looking at me about 4 to 5 feet above the ground. I could see a dark form below it. I could hear it stepping on what sounded like plastic pop bottles. I whistled at it, and to my amazement, it growled and whistled back at me in a low, deeper tone. I heard it do a wood knock twice. This all made me afraid, and I walked rapidly away and on to the apartments on the west side of the railroad tracks where I live. Also, about 4 weeks ago, late at night by the Brookside Cemetery, by the state police post, my girlfriend and I heard growling and wood knocks. It scared us, and we left very quickly. Bigfoot Sighting Report by J.W. On Wednesday, October 21st, 2015, I was driving along Valley Street of West Branch, where it curves to the east and follows the railroad tracks, about across from where the road on the south side curves from east to south. I was near, but east of, the UPS transfer plant. It was about 9:30 p.m. and was dark. I saw in my headlights of my truck on the railroad bed a very tall, probably in the 8 to 9 foot range, Bigfoot walking there. It was headed south and had very broad shoulders. It had a very long stride, not like a bear, and clearly was not a bear. As I neared it, it went very quickly from my view into the woods or swamp on the south side of the railroad tracks. As a side note, I have been hearing on occasion wood knocks near my home on North Fairview Road, which, along with other things, we have experienced in the past. Reports done by Phil Shaw, Bigfoot Researcher, November 2015. Hi, Nance. I've been listening. munching, breaking out in goosebumps, and laughing hysterically since its inception. It's a great channel. Before I get into my very short story, I just want to thank all of the hunters in Ohio, both bow and shotgun, whose dollars and volunteerism help to keep the game numbers safe from running into windshields and killing people, and also the necessary money donated by those same hunters that has been put into keeping the sport safe, secure, and not out of control. Balance is the aim here. Back in 1974, or maybe 1973, I can't remember which it is. I only would have been 9 or 10 at that time. But anyhow, my middle brother and I were visiting my grandparents in the Shoreland section of Toledo, Ohio. We always brought a fresh swatch of wax paper to put on the slide so we would zoom down it faster. We rode the swings, merry-go-round, and played on the monkey bars. Now, in this part of Toledo in Shoreland, it was beside the smaller and lesser-known river, the Ottawa River, and not by the Maumee River, which was by far the bigger river. Well, next to the Ottawa River at that time, some 47 years earlier, my brother and I got bored of the playground and decided to go into the cattail swamp west of the playground and sneak a cigarette. We weren't even inhaling yet. We were just sneaking. We would steal cigarettes from my dad's pack of Gold Winston 100s, those awful things, and then blow tremendous wafts of smoke in the air. They could probably see the smoke from the moon. Anyway, quicker than anyone could think or react, this thing clopped up to us fast and pushed off of my brother to hurry past us. I saw most of it, my brother not so much, except for its rear end and its white-bottomed bare feet running fast. It was beating its feet, let's just put it that way. To this day, I still don't know where it went, but there were swamps right up to Lake Erie back then. On this creature's run past the pair of us, it pushed off of my brother's left rib cage with what I'm assuming was its right hand. I do not think it meant to hurt my brother, but it only wanted to get away. In the process, it pushed my brother down, splintered two ribs, and bruised two more. You should have seen the spot where he was hurt. It was yellow, blue, purple, and green all at the same time. It looked as bad as it must have hurt. Before we looked at my brother's ribs, I can remember seeing this brown, furry creature run on by and push my brother in doing so. All I can totally remember was that its rear end was as big as a draft horse's butt. Only difference is that it was on two legs like a man, and it had a cone for a head. I wasn't completely sure on that feature then, but of course I am now. I was confused. My brother was too, and he was now covered in muck. Mom always put our good clothes on to visit Grandma, so he was due a good wooden spoon to the rear for that one. Back then, we all got spankings. After all, who was going to believe that we got knocked over by a monster in a cattail stand? What, were we going to tell them, "Yeah, Mom and Dad, we were lighting up one of your stolen Winstons, and a brown or black creature mowed my brother down"? See, either way, our gooses were cooked. My brother never wanted to talk about it since our doctor, Dr. Fink, I know, what a name, right? But if Dr. Fink thought my brother was crazy, then it surely had to be just some old man in the cattails or a bum hiding. All figured that he fell from something at the playground. My brother still won't speak about it to this day, and I've had two more encounters or sightings, so I know they're real. I'm a bow hunter, so it's possible to see them out in the woods. Usually, they just do an about-face and leave. I know of others who have seen them in Ohio and elsewhere as well. Every time I even broach the subject, my brother leaves or changes the subject. My brother isn't a wimp either. But I think it just scared him too bad. Plus, he had a hard time breathing for a while. He likes fishing in the open with others around, as opposed to hunting or private fishing. As for myself, I just try to be extra careful. I have a theory that they rarely hurt women. I could be wrong, though. The creepiest thing about all of this to me was that this creature or monster was watching us the whole time. Did it do that often? Did it enjoy watching human children? Kids were more free range back then. Who knows what would have happened to smaller children with no mom or dad around? My brother and I were very tall and, even back then, well above average. Luckily, no children were ever reported missing. The creature did not seem very big back then, so maybe it was a young creature. But it sure had a big butt and legs. We didn't even know what a Bigfoot or Sasquatch was back then. Well, there it is, Nance. Not too big of a story, but I know others wanted me to tell it anyway. Those cattails are long gone now, thankfully. Seems like when something bad happens with these creatures, they get run off or even killed, and killed in larger numbers out west. All I know is that the great state of Ohio is chock full of Sasquatch. Lori. Hello. I love the show, and I didn't have a sighting, but something did happen in the woods with me. This happened in the 1990s in Woodsfield, Ohio, on a farm that has 600 acres. It was the night before deer season, which was going to start in the morning. There's probably about 10 hunters, and we were standing around the campfire before we all went to sleep in a camper. It was kind of windy that night, so I really didn't go to sleep right away. I kept listening to the wind, but in the distance, I would hear tree knocks. Then in a few more minutes, I hear another set of tree knocks. Eventually, I get to sleep. In the morning, all the hunters set out to the farm, spreading out on the 600 acres. I eventually found the trail and started walking the trail. Now, this trail was full of evergreens, so it was pretty narrow. I started walking and then smelled this terrible smell, and I felt like someone was watching me. I didn't want to go any further, but I was frozen. I pointed my gun towards the trail and walked backwards, then eventually ran out of the evergreens and never went back there. I'm not really sure that's a Bigfoot story, but the farm is right next to the Wayne National Forest, and there's been quite a few Bigfoot stories coming from there. Well, I listen to the show just about every night, crazy as it sounds. I want to do some camping down there in Salt Fork and Hocking Hills. I love the show. You're doing a great job. Thanks. Go Buckeyes. David. I grew up near Cuyahoga Valley Park. I went there a lot, and I knew the park and the area well. I had gone one day to take a bunch of pictures. At 15, I thought I wanted to be a photographer, and I would save up all of my chore money and buy a roll or two of film whenever I could. My parents had gotten me a Canon AE-1 programmer the Christmas before. It was, and still is to this day, the most expensive Christmas gift that I've ever gotten that I didn't know about or pick out myself. Anyway, I loved that camera, and I tried to do a few rolls of film in it whenever I could afford it. So, that's what I'd been doing all that day, just going around the park, taking all kinds of what I thought were cool, landscapey pictures. This was June 1984. School was out, and it was ungodly hot, so the best thing I could do was go to the cool green of the park. It was only a couple miles from my house, and I could ride my bike. Over the day, I shot two rolls of film that I had with me and then started to head for home. I was riding a Schwinn Voyager. It was my brother's before it was handed down to me. But you see, the problem is, it was almost 5:30. I had forgotten to check the time during the day because I was so busy just riding around and taking pictures. I almost died when I saw the time. I was supposed to be home by 5 p.m. No excuses. My parents were real strict about us all having dinner together at 5 p.m. every day, and they had bought all of us kids watches just to make sure we knew the time and didn't have an excuse. Being late at my house was a really big deal. Since then, we've talked about it, and they told me that it really wasn't so much about the dinner that they were being hard-nosed with. They just wanted to teach all of us to be aware, to be responsible, and to keep deadlines and commitments. Well,
It worked.
I'm a stickler for being on time to this day. But anyway, I packed up that day quickly, got on my bike, and got out of there like a bat out of heck. I was riding out on Columbia, heading west, and it's still light out for me to see. I was really pedaling as hard and as fast as I could. I was scared to death. I was a couple miles still from my house. I knew there was no way I was going to make it home before they were mad. But every minute that I was later, the worse it was going to be. So I'm just trucking along as fast as the Schwinn Voyager would go. I was being careful, trying to listen for any cars that were coming or going, and I was riding facing traffic as I had been taught to do. Mostly all I heard was my own breathing. But I heard all kinds of foresty sounds beside the road, and they got louder, loud enough that I could hear them over pedaling and breathing hard. Now that stretch of Columbia had lots of trees on either side. And even in the summer, it was shady and dark. There was a canopy of trees over the road. I was pedaling hard through there, barely letting my bum touch the seat. The bike was going from side to side while I pedaled like that. I looked over to the trees and thought I saw something back there moving. What I saw, really, was mostly leaves and branches moving, at first, anyway. But I kept hearing something, so I kept looking over. I was getting spooked now, and though I wasn't supposed to, I veered my bike out to the very middle of the road and tried to pedal even faster. But I was tired. I was used to biking, but not like this, not this fast, and not for this long. I kept looking over to my left, and then I saw it. I saw an animal of some kind that seemed to be walking really fast through all the green stuff. I didn't know what to call it at the time, but it was just an animal. I knew it wasn't human. And I saw that it wasn't running, but it was still keeping up with me on my bike. You might call it a small jog it was doing, but it was not a run. It didn't seem to be running. Now I was really scared. I didn't know any animals like that were around there. I had never seen a real bear, but I also knew immediately that it wasn't a bear. I couldn't think of anything else that's big, hairy, and dark that runs through the forest. And the only thing I came up with was a bear, but I knew it wasn't a bear. Now, I only got a couple looks from the side of it, but it seemed very tall, even from that distance with me out on the road. Dark and hairy, I mostly only saw bits of it from maybe the chest up or the shoulders and up, over the brush. But there was a definite head, and once it kind of turned and looked at me, I just know it did. I saw it. I should say also that its shoulders looked slope and rounded to me when it turned to look at me. Now, I think I was leaning the bike back and forth while trying to ride faster, and I must have done it too fast or too hard, or maybe I hit some gravel. All I know is one second I'm pedaling, and the next second, my skin was kissing the pavement with a lot of blood. Even when I went down and when I was grating my skin off on the road as I skidded, I was trying to look and see where the animal was or what it was. I just kept looking that way. And I saw that it didn't stop. It kept going up a little bit ahead on the side of the road. But then I saw it did stop, like maybe 50 feet or something. Like it just realized that I wasn't on my bike over there on the road anymore. It stopping scared me even more. I was getting up and getting on my bike at that moment, and then all the burning pain was coming through to my brain from all the road rash. Really, can you say road rash all down my left side? Because that's what I had. Anyway, that's when I realized it had stopped. I had just managed to get the bike upright and was getting on it, and now I was really scared. I thought it was waiting up there for me, that it was going to get me, it was going to kill me, it was going to eat me, and all the stuff a 15-year-old that likes to watch scary movies at night would think. I guess it thought the game or the race or whatever was over or something, because I didn't see it anymore. I kept looking. I was terrified. But it moved away further into the woods and trees. I could hear it. I was perplexed, but relieved. I was scared, still, but I pedaled home as fast as I could, despite the pain.
I had big, raw, strawberry red patches that were so raw and bloody, and they were wet looking. When I went down, somehow my shirt got pushed up, and the left side of my torso was now a big, red, wet, glistening streak. The hard part now for me was that I couldn't bear to have my shirt cover it. But if I took my shirt off and pedaled, well, the wind on all that raw skin stung and burned. It was a bad dilemma. My left leg and arm weren't in much better shape. I must have looked quite the sight to the cars that I passed that day, all road rash, red, and bloody wet. I know I got a few looks from the passing cars, but I didn't make eye contact with them. I didn't want them to stop. I didn't want their help. I just wanted to go home, and I just kept pedaling as fast as I could. I was just coming down the street that led to my street when I saw my dad coming down the road in the car. He had come looking for me because I was never late as a rule. And I didn't get in any trouble, though. Mom and Dad took one look at me and those bright red streaks, and that was it. I told them that I took a tumble on the road and that it took a while till I could ride and pedal the bike again, and that I had spent a long time walking my bike part of the way. And they believed me, and I wasn't in any trouble. And strangely, I was so relieved, that's all I could think about. Incredibly, that Canon camera in the fancy bag that my parents bought for it, even though we both hit the road, it was just fine and was still strapped to the back of my bike. The bag was all scuffed up on the side that hit the road, but the camera inside was just fine. Yes, I really was very worried about that. You know, I still have that camera today. I did tell my friends what happened eventually. Most didn't believe me. Or they said what I saw was a bear. Everyone had a perfectly logical reason for what I saw. But one said that, you know, his dad said that we had Bigfoot in this area, and that's what it sounded like to him. I hadn't even thought of maybe Bigfoot, but I did then, and I started trying to find out everything I could on Bigfoot. And that's easier said than done in 1984, 1985, when all you have are a couple small libraries around you, but no internet. But yeah, I do think that that was a Bigfoot that day. Everything I have heard and read since then fits the description. I don't know what it wanted exactly. I think it just wanted to play, or it thought we were racing. I know this. I was laying there, helpless, all raw and bleeding on the road for a few seconds. If it wanted me, it could have hurt me, but it didn't. And that's what I remember most. Thanks, Bruce. Bigfoot Incident at Karen's Stakeout in Her Backyard by Karen, Rick Brenner, Larry Kohler, Phil Shaw, and Hank and Sue Beam, Friday night, September 8, 2017. We started a campfire about 8 p.m. in the fire pit Karen had dug. We did some wood knocks and howls. At about 10:30 p.m., a substantial rock was thrown against Karen's picket fence, probably from the wooded area to the east. Everyone heard it, and we all agreed it could not have been an apple falling from her apple tree by the back picket fence. Several looked for the rock, but could not find it. At about 11 p.m., several had wandered down behind the barn on the back of Karen's mowed yard area. Rick and Hank saw an orb down by the pond's water edge, but Rick says it moved up to near them about 20 feet away and was quite small, only 5 inches in diameter. As Phil came over the hill by the barn to join the group, he saw the orb as well, and it was very bright, somewhat bigger than a basketball. But as he watched, it briefly turned off after only a few minutes. It could not have been moon glow, as it was not up yet, and not swamp gas, as it was too defined. Phil thought it was the others down by the water, but Karen says there was no path through the wet bog to the water's edge, about 40 yards, and they could not get there. She surmised it was the leech gatherers, but Phil says we would have heard more flashing lights and voice noise. It was somewhat light due to the clear sky and stars glowing. At about 11:30 p.m., some howling started to the west by Tracy's house, and the dogs quieted, and everyone heard them,
and they seem to be too low and too growly to be dog or coyote or wolf howling. At about 12:30 p.m., additional howls came from the north, then east, then south, and west. Those howls were higher, but still not like possible coyote howls. We agreed the different howls were likely Bigfoot howling. We ended the stakeout about 1:30 p.m. This report was done by Phil Shaw, West Branch Bigfoot Researcher, Michigan. J.W. Bigfoot Incidents. From video dated April 18, 2020 on Phil Shaw's YouTube channel. I and my wife Starla own 20 acres of property on Wallen Lake Drive off Fairview Road, West Branch, Michigan. We have lived here 26 years and own a business in West Branch. First report. Prior to coming to West Branch, I saw a Bigfoot in about 1979 near Crystal Falls in the Upper Peninsula. My friend John and I were driving down a two-track, and then a hairy bipedal animal came onto and ran down the road for about 50 to 75 yards before it darted into the forest. It was about 8 to 9 feet tall, and the hair was about 10 inches long and light dirty brown in color. It was very agile and fast on its 2 feet. We saw no neck, and my friend John saw it look around, but I didn't. He saw no particular features. That sighting lasted about 15 to 20 seconds long, and we were amazed. The location was 2 to 3 miles from our cabin near Fin Lady Swamp, which is about 100 miles square. Second report. In early December 2011, Starla, I and our neighbors Don and Pam, who live about a mile to the west of us in a more remote area, were having a campfire and we heard screams and howls in the distance, about 1/4 mile away. That also happened again in October 2012. We have listened to Bigfoot sounds on the computer, and these sounds are very close to them. They have heard those sounds over their TV in their well-insulated house. Third report. My friend Don Carlos and I were talking on our phones, and we heard wood knocks from about 100 to 200 feet away. That happened still about 1 or 2 times a month. Fourth report. In September 2010, we were visiting away from our home, and upon returning home, we found our storage shed, which is about 100 yards from our house, torn apart, the door ripped. A 50-pound bag of carrots that I had stored was missing from the shed. The door has a 2x6 frame, 1-inch board covering, and the hinges are heavy types. I believe a bear would not have thrown the door away, nor taken the carrots. A bear would have torn the bag open and eaten them on the spot. Report 5. We came home one time in about February 2010 and found our woodshed, which is attached to our home, partly emptied of firewood, and it was spread out behind the shed out about 20 feet. We have a lot of chipmunks, and the possible Bigfoot may have been trying to get at them. About a row of wood was removed and thrown out of the building. Report number 6. We also have had substantial trees broken off near our home. One was broken in June 2011 and was only 40 feet from our home, was about 5 inches in diameter, and had broken off 5 to 6 feet high and in good weather. There is no way it could have been snow load nor wind shear. We have found other trees up to 10 inches in diameter broken off with no logical reason. Report number 7. In February 2010, at about 10 to 11 p.m., something shook our house. Since our house is of pole barn construction, it is very sturdy. It was a thud, thud, and then the shake. There was nobody else in the neighborhood, as most people here go south for the winter. It was not an earthquake, but something very strong shook the house. Report number 8. In December 2012, we had an eyeshine event. I was outside in the late evening and looked to the east, which goes downhill somewhat. With my flashlight, I saw 2 orange eyes about 10 inches apart. It looked at me for a few moments and then turned and walked away. I could not tell the height of the animal as it goes downhill a bit behind a flower arbor, which is about 7 feet tall, so the animal could have been up to 11 feet tall. These reports taken by Phil Shaw, West Branch, Michigan Bigfoot Researcher. Hi, everybody. As promised, I've written the rest of my encounters. I moved to the North Georgia Mountains in 2002. At the time, I had just finished massage therapy school. Massage was to be my midlife crisis second career after nursing for 20 years. The plan was to set up my fledgling massage practice in Blue Ridge, Georgia, and live in an even smaller town nearby, close to the Ocoee River. In addition to being a weekend warrior, I also taught whitewater kayaking at a local outfitter and spent the summer of 2002 raft guiding for the same company on weekends. It was a busy year, and I was living in an apartment that was fraught with problems with the landlord. When it was finally time to move, at the encouragement of a realtor, instead of apartment hunting, I went house hunting. By now, it was September of 2003. I found my house, a solid little ranch style in a pretty, tree-lined, quiet neighborhood. It was wonderful to own a home in a small, rural town of 1,000 people. The year before, I had taken in a small rescue dog and was looking forward to walking her around our hilly neighborhood, which would be good exercise for us both. It started the first night I took my dog, Katie, out for a walk late in the evening. At 11 p.m., I felt a bit uneasy at first, but then had the thought, hey, I'm in the country. I'm perfectly safe out here. Most of my life had been lived in cities up north. I told myself that, unlike the city, I had nothing to worry about now. Katie Dog and I trotted happily up the street. At the top of the hill was a wooded area to our left. As we walked by, a rock came flying out of the trees and landed at my feet. We stopped, and I heard whispering voices in the trees where the rock was thrown. Another rock came flying at us, not hitting either of us, and again, there was more whispering in the trees. Assuming it was kids being rude, I yelled, "Hey, I just moved to this neighborhood. That's not very nice." Again, I heard the whispering. I just continued our walk, determined not to let this bother me. We walked a bit further, and when we started back down our street, another rock came flying out of the same wooded spot and landed at my feet. I knew whoever this was, obviously, wasn't trying to hurt me. They were just trying to get my attention, but it was still annoying. Further down the hill, just before reaching my house, was an abandoned house across the street. A distinct whistle came from somewhere in the vicinity of this house. I thought someone was trying to call to my dog, so I kept her from investigating and hightailed it to our house. Again, I was more irritated at the whistling than scared. I thought it was possibly one of the men in the neighborhood who had stopped by to talk to me that day, assuming a divorced middle-aged woman was an easy target. This one guy in particular liked my dog, and it sounded like he was whistling to her in a pitch from low to high, almost like a slide whistle. The next morning, I noticed something on the wall in my carport. There were two little woven things, looking like they were made of straw or dried grass. The designs were odd, strangely braided. All I could think was they were some strange Appalachian gift that a guy might make for a girl he's interested in. I just left them there, not wanting to take the bait. They were gone the next day. As the days, weeks, and months went by, I noticed more oddities. Under the trees in my yard were sticks pushed into the ground at strange intervals. Branches of a pine tree at the corner of my property were broken off, high up from the base of the tree. I had a pear tree in the backyard that was prolific with fruit. The plan was to pick the pears when they were big and ripe enough. However, when I went to harvest them, the fruit on the lower branches was gone, some of it on the ground half-eaten. I assumed some animal, like the deer that was passing through the yard, were able to stretch their necks up for the pears. That didn't deter me. I got a ladder and climbed up to try for the fruit that was higher in the tree. But the pears I could reach now were all half-eaten, like the ones on the ground, and by something with a large mouth. I wondered if a bear had come through at night and stretched itself up to the higher branches for a nibble. Speaking of deer coming through the neighborhood, one night, when Katie and I stepped out of the house and started walking up the street, several deer came flying up the street perpendicular to us. They were hell-bent for leather. I'd never seen deer run that fast. I just guided Katie down the opposite way and did a shorter walk in our neighborhood. And that nasty smell from that summer on the Ocoee River in 2004? I came home from work one evening in the autumn, taking my sheets from my massage practice to my laundry room, which is at the end of the carport. When I opened the door, that same fetid odor hit me. It made me wonder what animal had been hanging around in my laundry room, so close to my back door. There were strange noises at night, and even some in the daytime. One day, when I had the rare opportunity to come home for lunch, I was walking Katie up the street, up the hill, when I heard a loud wood knock. My neighbor was in her yard, and we started talking. As we chatted, there was another loud knock, which we ignored, and then another. I asked her if that was a woodpecker. It didn't sound like any woodpecker I'd ever heard before, but maybe there was some bird like it, making this sound a singular whack on a tree. My neighbor assured me, no, that was not a woodpecker. But she didn't offer what else it might be. Sometimes, very late at night or the very early hours of the morning, there was tapping on my bedroom window. Checking around the house didn't reveal any nearby branches that could be making the tapping. I'm grateful now I didn't look out my window at night. If I'd seen a Bigfoot, it would have terrorized me. We continued our late-night walks, accompanied at times by strange howling, and for a time screaming that sounded like a woman was being attacked. One massage client told me it was made by a panther. Another said, we didn't have big cats in the area. This proved untrue when I almost hit a tawny-colored cougar that ran out in front of my slow-moving car in broad daylight. The thought of a panther in the neighborhood was scary, but also kind of exciting. My dog Katie would look up at the trees as we walked by, but no big cats emerged, thank goodness. One night, while walking in the immediate neighborhood, we walked by one of the houses that bordered a large wooded area that continued on downhill toward the Toccoa River. That woman in distress screaming was very loud, sounding like it was from the back of the house. When I got home, I called the police and told them I thought someone was in trouble, as the screaming sounded distinctly human. They asked me where it was coming from. When I told them, they said, oh, don't worry about it. We know what it is. When I asked if it was a panther, they said no, and again, not to worry. There were times walking Katie in the daytime in and around our neighborhood when I would get the heebie-jeebies about walking in a particular area, especially an area that was thickly wooded. It felt like I was getting a mental message, don't walk any further. And Katie responded differently to things we heard, saw, and felt. Sometimes she would bark and growl, trying to go after whatever was in the tree line or bushes. Sometimes she would stand stock still and stare, like me, trying to figure out what we were looking at. There were a few mornings when I had to go in early to work. I would take her out for her morning constitutional just after dawn, and she wasn't having any part of it. I would half drag her across my yard, trying to get her to do her business before she was locked inside for most of the day. But she would have her tail between her legs, pulling me back toward the house as hard as she could. I'd get mad at her, wondering why she was acting that way. Knowing what I do now, I think there may have been a Bigfoot or two possibly hiding in the wooded area just behind my backyard. Then there were possible sightings before the definitive sighting. Walking through my property from the street one night, I noticed something moving underneath my deck. There is a lattice covering that partially hides the underside of the deck. I didn't have anything stored under there at the time, and it looked like two bulky people in ski jackets were laying down under there, trying not to be seen. This was one time Katie was quiet. I was planning on walking across my yard to the house, which would take us right by the deck. But then I thought we'd better walk around the yard, staying on the street until we got to the house. Whoever or whatever was under there was not something I wanted to come into contact with. Another time, It looked like a very tall, thin man was standing on the corner of my neighbor's property. But this was a good way off, and the streetlight wasn't giving much detail. Another time, when Katie and I were starting up the street, it looked like there was a man trying to peer into my neighbor's house. From the streetlight, it looked like he had a bulky jacket on, and a winter hat with a short visor on it. I have since seen the side view of a Sasquatch on Scott Carpenter's book cover, Truth Denied, the Sasquatch DNA Study, and it made me jump, because that's exactly what it looked like. Again, my dog just stopped and stared, like I did. This person saw me, jumped down on all fours, and ran behind a big pine tree. I just stood there, not sure what to do. And then it looked like it ran into the bushes underneath her front windows. This was confusing because it suddenly looked smaller, and I thought maybe it was just a dog and continued to walk Katie down the street this time, not up the hill, keeping my eye on the tree in my neighbor's yard. It just gave me a weird feeling. All this was going on from the time I moved in 2003 till the time my sweet little Katie died in 2014. There were more oddities, house slaps, two tall guys talking in low voices in the backyard across the street. A strange figure that appeared in shadow at my front door window with a domed head and no neck with bulky shoulders. By this time, after 2007, I had brought my mother to live with me. We were playing cards in the living room with my sister who was visiting. When I saw that shape in the small window of my front door, I yelled, "What's that?" and it disappeared. My sister's back was to the door, and when I told her what I saw, she turned to look and there was nothing there. Her reaction was, "Are you nuts?" Mom was 89 at the time. She is now 101 and still with me. I read to her at night, sing a hymn, and recite prayers together, and there have been times, even recently, when I've heard low voices outside her bedroom window when I finish singing. The definitive encounters occurred around the time the TV show Finding Bigfoot started. Though not a huge fan of the show, it was teaching me about Bigfoot behavior. Rock throwing, whispering in the trees, whistling, wood knocks, how they look, how they sound, were all things I had been experiencing. Not knowing anything about them prior to this, not believing it was real, watching the show in its early days was a good source of information. A good eye-opener. One night, walking down the hill toward the house, the closer we got to home, I heard a loud howling. It started low and deep, climbed to a sustained ah-ooh sound, and then tapered off. It sounded like it was just down the street, and I thought it might be a lost hunting dog who was in trouble. A friend had recently rescued an emaciated hunting dog she found at a nearby river. I put my little dog in the house and went back out to look for this animal that sounded in distress. Now, though there was more than one howling going on, and it sounded much closer to the house. By the time I got to the end of my short driveway, I was overwhelmed by fear. A very strong thought came to me, "Go back in the house and don't come out again." I obeyed the thought, ran back into the house, though I kept wondering where the heck such a strong, distinct thought had come from. Soon after, either on the TV show or on the internet, I heard an example of the Ohio howl. The hair on the back of my neck stood up. That's exactly what I had heard. From then on, I only walked Katie around our immediate neighborhood, but soon after would limit that to our yard. One night, as we walked around the neighborhood, I had the distinct feeling of being followed. I had felt this before, but not with the intensity I felt that night. As we walked up a steep little hill toward the street, Katie stopped again to sniff around. I looked down the hill, and crossing the street at the bottom of the hill we just came up, diagonally on all fours, was a creature that looked like a lanky gorilla. It had that distinctive dome-shaped head and loped across the street. It was not a bear. I've seen bears cross the street, and almost hit one while driving one night. This was not running the way a bear would. By now, I knew what it was, and it appeared to be heading toward the back of a group of houses whose backyards abutted up to mine. I said, "Run, Katie!" And we ran past a few houses till we reached ours. I knew this thing could beat us to my door if it wanted to, but fortunately it didn't. Gratefully, I didn't hear anything that night. No house slaps, howling, or growling, and didn't see any dark shapes as I furtively peeked out the curtains. After that, things seemed to quiet down when we stuck to walking only in the front and side yards of my property. Maybe that's what they wanted, for me to stop walking around the area late at night. I very rarely saw another person on those walks, just occasionally deer, once in a while packs of wild dogs, and apparently a few Bigfoot. I've never felt the need to leave my home, never felt threatened. I've definitely felt scared, and the need, even now when I take the trash out at night, to be careful and watchful of my surroundings. Until last spring, I thought all the activity had stopped. Some of the heavier wooded areas near my house have been thinned out, but there's still a small grouping of trees and bushes just behind my backyard. Last spring and summer, there was some activity which caused me to look up Bigfoot online again. From there, I discovered all these YouTube channels where so many people were posting their sightings and sharing information. Buckeye Bigfoot was among these. Because I spent my first year at UC and had lived in Ohio later on for a short while, I had to subscribe to Nance's channel. After all, I did experience an Ohio howl firsthand. Thanks again, Nance, for this platform to share our encounters. Although this was long, there's still stuff I'm forgetting and a few things I just have to leave out for now. But I needed to tell you this. Love to you and to all the SAS squad. Sue.